ready for the word? I just want to say that I really appreciate Pastor Vernon Bryant. Amen. I believe God sent him to this ministry for such a time as this. Amen. He's been an asset, and just through him, the ministry has expanded. And I just wanted to say that. Amen. Amen. But let's give the Lord some praise for Pastor Vernon Bryant as he brings the word.
Hallelujah. Amen. That's one of my bosses right there, so I don't know if that's a setup or what. Sometimes they encourage you and give a good word about you. It's a setup. Sometimes it's a setup. Wait for what tomorrow may bring. Come on, let's give the Lord some praise. Come on, let's give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give him some praise. Give him some praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's open up the heavens. Let's open up the heavens. Come on, somebody, open up the heavens. Hallelujah. Lift them up. Lift them up. All day long, he has took care of you. All day long, he's watched over us. All day long, he's kept us strong. Come on, his faith, his love, his mercy, his grace has been all around us. Hallelujah. Amen. I just love to just praise the Lord and just, oh, take every opportunity to praise him. You know, I get excited about praising him. You know, I praise him like my savings account going to increase. You know, I praise him like something new finna happen in my life. You know, sometimes you got to ask God for something and then start praising him like it already has happened. Amen? You have to praise him like it has already happened. Amen. You can be exceeded. You can be seated. Amen. This is an awesome time. I'm so excited about what God is doing in my life. I give honor to him. I'm so excited about what he's doing in the life of my wife. I honor her tonight. And I give honor to our bishop. I give honor to all the pastors, all the leadership, and everyone that is here tonight. I honor you for taking out your time to come and fellowship with us. You chose to be here tonight. This is your free time, and you chose to give it to the kingdom of God. You chose to come into a place and obey the word of God and assemble together and to give his name praise and glory and honor. So I honor you on that tonight for taking this time out to show up and, you know, giving me someone to talk to. So I thank God for you. You know, we serve an awesome God. We serve an awesome God. And we're in the midst of a great, I think we're in the midst of a great revival that is moving in our midst. But it's not like a revival of the past. I think it's. I'm not saying that God is doing a new thing. Don't miss me. I'm saying that it is a revival of a different mold. It is a revival of a different form, what God is doing. See, sometimes things that they are not necessarily dead, they are alive, but they don't know how to function. So sometimes a revival can come through to teach you how to function under certain circumstances. See, revivals is not always about packing the house, and it's not about laying hands and blowing on someone and they falling down and all that stuff. And revival is about a change taking place on the inside of an individual. I said an individual. You know, so in society, we so used to a revival being a great, huge outpouring. Yes, that is true. We have had those. But I just believe that there's a revival that is taking place, and this revival is one about molding people for leadership. It's about shifting people into position. It's about allowing those that are called to do a great work to realize their call. See, there are people that God want to use. If you're not with me, I'm already taking off. I'm already gone. We already own it right now. There are people that God wants to use in ministry. Now, I'm not talking about staffing a church. I'm talking about the ministry of living the gospel as a lifestyle. The ministry of your life being a witness for the kingdom. So there is a revival that's taking place for people to be put in place and to have the faith to say what they're supposed to say, to do what they're supposed to do, and to live how they're supposed to live. For so long, a lot of individuals have been trying to live, just simply live peacefully. Just get from one day to the next and not struggle financially, not struggle with unhappiness, not struggle with physical pain, not struggle with depression. For so long, a lot of people have just sought after God just to get past the basic things, the milk situations. But God is moving in a way now that he is saying, I want you to look beyond those things, and will you press for greater things than that? Can you put a demand on the kingdom to show up in your life now? See, there are some people that know how to put a demand on the kingdom now. And a lot of us, we just sit back and watch them on television. A lot of us, we just read their books. A lot of us, you know, we just hear about them. And a lot of us, we talk about them, and we see them on the news. But it has come a time where God is saying, why are you holding back? Why have you separated yourself when I have already made it an opportunity for you to go after? So what God is doing, and I'm so excited because it's like it's things that are happening, and it's great to be in this church and be in the midst of it. You know, I understand, you know, we have, you know, the tomb, and I understand the magnitude of this week and these days that are building up, and traditional churches and religion and ritualistic places of worship. There are a lot of things that are going to take place this week and building up to this weekend. There are a lot of things that's going to take place, you know, on Sunday morning, and a lot of showing going to take place, and a lot of traditional stuff is going to take place. And this is a week, you know, of celebration and the resurrection and the power of the resurrection, and a lot of celebrating is going to be going on. But I think it's amazing that our church is studying about battling. How do you go from the week of resurrection and preparing for the all the hoopla that goes with that, and you are teaching on called to battle, destined to win? And we're in a lesson concerning battling. It's talking about fighting. It's talking about going after something. It's talking about being soldiers. Now, if you know anything about battling, you know anything about war, you know anything about fighting, that is not always a joyous situation. You know, battling makes you think of, you know, fighting, some anger. It makes you think about an enemy. It makes you think about something that's trying to attack you or go against you. So I'm trying to figure out over the next couple days the celebration part and the battling part, because they both have to tie in at some point. It has to be a reason for the celebration, but it also has to be a reason that we're studying about battling. The celebration gonna happen because he's already risen. Come on, you know this is just an example. The celebration is already what we're living. But is there anyone that's in a battle tonight? Is there anyone fighting tonight? If you are breathing and you're in your right frame of mind, let me help you out. You in a battle. Okay. Some of y'all shaking y'all head no. Yeah, yes you are. Yes you are. You're in a battle. You just lied in church. But we are in a battle because Satan in himself does not desire to see us victorious. We're in a battle because the enemy in this world, his determination is to destroy us, to kill us. That's his determination. The battle, though there is a battle, we have already cheated in the process of the battle. Y'all cheaters. It's a fixed fight. We have already won the fight, so the battle is something that is going on around us, but are we really fighting? You can't really fight something you've already won. Come on, somebody. You can't really fight something that you already won, but what you can do is learn the levels of your victory. Some of us don't understand the levels of our victory. Sometimes you can win. Okay, thank you, Holy Ghost. I know of a situation years ago, someone that won the lottery. They won millions of dollars, and their life changed. They moved from the ghetto to a nice home in a nice area with millions of dollars. But the problem was their understanding of what they had was not on the level of a million-dollar lifestyle. They had a million but did not understand what a million meant. They had victory, but they did not understand what victory meant to them. So what happened was individuals that knew what a $1 million meant became their best friends. And slowly but surely, they went from a million to nothing, to bankrupt, to broke. And all of their $1 million friends that knew what a million meant, they went away. They vanished with their money. So that's why it's very important. You can be victorious. We can have power. God can anoint us. God can call us to a certain area of ministry. But if you don't understand what you have, you don't understand how to use it. It's like having weapons. We're talking about going into battle. It's like being a soldier and having a weapon, but you don't know how to shoot. And you're running into the battle with a gun, but you don't know how to shoot. The person on the other side will shoot you with your gun in your hand if you don't know how to use it. Same thing with warfare. Even in spiritual warfare, if you don't understand how to use the word of God, then you wouldn't know how to use it when you're in battle. Because there are certain battles that happen in life that you will need to understand the word of God and how to use his word in battle. So that's why we fellowship together. That's why we come into the house and fellowship together, that we can be taught and we can learn together. But I'm here to tell you tonight, your most effective learning is what you do on your own time. Your most effective learning is what you do in your personal time. It's when you're one-on-one with him. It's when you are giving your heart and your attention to him one-on-one. Coming together in fellowship is wonderful. It strengthens the body. But the body also is strengthened through individual personal time with Jesus. When I turn off the television, when I turn off the computer, when I put down my cell phone, when I put down the laptop, when I put down the iPad, and I take time out and I say, this time I'm going to give to you. It is a very, and I'm being realistic tonight, it is a very hard thing in the lives of a lot of individuals today to put down a cell phone. It is a hard, people drive down the highway with a cell phone, operating a cell phone. I see people in line at a restaurant, they can't order their food from looking up at the menu and looking down at their cell phone. It's amazing that I was just in a store and I was walking, I was watching them, and I began to play a game. I started counting the people with a cell phone, pushing a shopping cart with a cell phone. It is amazing the hook that we in a society have become accustomed to. We are accustomed to it. So I challenge you, because this is a huge challenge. The phone is an area of temptation for a lot of people. I challenge you to take time out to turn it off and give it to Jesus. Turn it off and give a moment to the Lord. Turn off the text just for a moment. I heard one time that someone gave a three-minute challenge. I think it was Pastor West for the youth. 3 minutes. Have we come to a point that we have to struggle for 3 minutes? Think about where we're at. Think about what's going on in our life if 3 minutes is a struggle. Let's think about it. We're talking about spending time with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Can we give him more than 3 minutes? Can we give him more than that? Can we give him more than that? There are things that have risen in many of our lives that are battles. I know we're talking about spiritual battles. I know we're talking about, you know, called to battle and destined to win, and we're talking about warfare. But there are some individual things in our life that we need to deal with, that a lot of us have been struggling with for years and years and years, that have slowed us down from the race for a long time, that we really need to deal with. And we have sought many different methods. We have prayed about it. We talked about it. They have laid hands on us about it. We've written books about it, poems about it, talked on the phone for hours about it. Yet we're still struggling with it. Because it comes a point in time in life where you have to take the battle to the battle, where you have to take the fight to the enemy, where you have to take the fight to them. I remember when I was a young boy when I was in middle school. And I remember I had a problem with this bully. And this bully would just, you know, just beat me up every day. You know, after school, I ride the bus home, and me and this bully rode the same bus. And every day the bully would get off the bus and beat me up. And so when I go home, you know, I have bumps and bruises all over me. And I used to tell my mom, well, I was playing hard in the playground. Or I failed at school. I had many excuses that I was telling her, you know, because I didn't want to admit that I was getting beat up when I was in middle school. And I remember one time that I got off the bus and the bully beat me up again. And I remember once I got home and I told my mom, and she like, I don't want to hear it. Somebody already told me you've been getting beat up. And I'm telling you that you better not come in this house again beat up. Because if you do, I'm going to beat you up next. Anybody ever had a mama like that? If you don't do something, when you get home, it's going to be me and you. So all day, I'm talking about a battle now. All day I was concerned about how I'm going to beat up that bully. The bully was bigger than me, taller than me. Yeah, I think it was about 6'6", 6'9", 6'. We was in middle school, so that was a big one. 6'6", 6 something. Glory to God, 6 something. 200 and... I mean, I don't know how big they can get in middle school, but 200 and some. But the bully was bigger than me. And the bully was stronger than me. And I didn't believe that I could beat this bully. But I was more afraid of my mom than this bully. It's one thing to get beat up after school, but it's another thing to go home and get beat up all day long. So I had to figure out something to stop this. I had to figure out a way to win this. I got to stop this. So I remember I made up in my mind, and I took a stick, and I hid it by the bus stop. And I said, I'm ready for that bully. I'm ready for him. I'm not going to take it no more because I'm going home happy today. So I remember when we got to the bus stop and the bus stop, and I remember when she stepped off the bus. Yeah, I said she, it was a girl. Lord, Lord, help me. I remember when she stepped off the bus. And I knew this was the time. I got to do something. I got to do something. She can't whoop me today. I can't do it. And I remember I picked up the stick and I said, it's on today. And she was standing there, 6'6", 200. And she was big. She had failed two years in a row. They held her back. She was big. I stood there, and I stood there, and I was firm, and I had made up my mind. This is it. And she looked at me, and I looked at her. And she looked at me, and I looked at her. And we didn't fight that day. She didn't beat me up that day. Because it was something about my stance. It was something about the stance that I took. I said no more. I said no more. Because I wasn't concerned about her at the time. I was concerned about my mama. I knew what was waiting for me at home. That's what I was concerned about. And even though I knew she had been held back 2 years, this was an adult. This girl was big. In middle school, this is a grown lady. But as I stood there, I took a stance. And again, I say, I took a stance because I was more concerned about home and what was waiting for me. I have a revelation tonight. We as men and women of God, it's time that we take a stance and be more concerned about our Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ, to be more about concerned about what God has done for us. It's time that we take a stand, not a stand of fear, but a stand of righteousness. It's time to take a stand. I'm more concerned about Jesus. I am more concerned about his call on my life. We have to be more concerned about the kingdom. So when we go to battle, we take a stance because we are concerned about what he has done for us. I'm taking a stand because I knew who I was and I know what he done. I know how he changed me. My stance is more, I'm not concerned about the enemy in front of me. I'm more concerned about the kingdom because he has called us into the kingdom. See, this battle, call to battle, is what we're studying. And tonight, as a topic, if I can take a topic. See, that's just the buildup. Now I'm preaching right now. That was the buildup. If I may take a topic, and we're talking about call to battle, destined to win. But if I can talk about a topic I would like to talk about tonight, we will win while we're in the battle. I'm talking about while we're in the battle. We will win while we are in the battle. Come on, let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 6. Let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 6. Is this good? Is this good? Hallelujah. Some of y'all laughing at me. You done been beat up by girls too. Yeah. Some of them adults, but now they call that domestic. Domestic. They call that assault now. Aggravated stalking. Let's look at 1 Timothy chapter 6. And I want to go down to verse 12 of 1 Timothy 6, verse 12. And it reads, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. Fight the good fight of faith. Fight the good fight of faith. We have to understand and grow in the knowledge of faith has to become a position that we take in life. You know, a lot of us, we utilize faith for things that we want. And we utilize faith for things that we desire. And we take faith for the unseen. And we take that scripture and we run with it. And we believe by faith for things that we desire in our heart. But I stand here tonight to say to you, we win in the battle when we take faith as a position, as a stance. See, my faith tonight, in this moment, the faith that I stand on is the faith knowing that I win in every single battle I face in life. There is nothing that can come against me in life that can defeat me. So my faith is a faith of standing on the fact that I know that I have victory. Now, some of us have faced some traumatic things in life. And people may look at us and wonder, how could they possibly still stand? How could they still have faith? How can they still believe? You know, some decisions we have made in life, and some people say, man, how did you have faith to do that? You know, what kind of faith did it take to do that? Well, when you have gone through enough things in life and seen what God can do, and when you understand that your life is one that is of a sacrifice freely given to him, when you freely give it to him, you say that you are subject to whatever he wants to do with it. When you freely give it to him, you allow him to use it for his glory. You see, when I operated in sin, I did that for my glory and for my flesh. But when I surrendered to him, now my life is for his glory, for his benefit. So then faith for me is just a position. It's just a place that I stand. It's just a place that I live in. I live in it. I operate in it. I see something. I desire something. I don't have to hope for that. I don't have to run and jump on my knees and start praying for that. I walk in the existence of, if it's for me and if it's in God's will and plan, my faith is a position that I shall have that. Does that make sense? So I don't find myself chasing pleasures anymore. See, sin causes you to chase pleasures. You know what I'm saying? It does. You try one thing, but that only lasts for so long, so you try something else and something else and something else. And the whole time when you think you're getting pleasure, you are physically, spiritually dying. Because that's how the flesh operates. But in the kingdom, the pleasures and the joys that we receive, they are eternal and continuous. The greatest thing about salvation and eternal life is the fact that it does not end. We won't die. It does not end. The flesh may go away. The flesh shall pass away. but the soul will continue. So I can operate in this flesh. I mean, operate in this faith. You caught that? I can operate in this faith continually and receive everything from the King. Because the flesh only wants us to operate in it to satisfy the flesh. But my mentality and my heart is one of the Spirit now, so I operate by faith, and it does not satisfy the flesh. Why? Because the spiritual man is more alive in me. The spiritual man is more alive in you now. There has been an adjustment. The leader has changed positions. Who's in charge now is the spirit man. And the flesh is subject. It has to line up because I have a position by faith. Can I work with this tonight? Faith has took a position in my life. Faith has took a position in your life. Faith has took a position in our life. That we don't have to worry about falling. Come on, Faith Home. That stigmatism about falling, we don't have to walk in existence and be concerned about falling. Let faith be your position. So let whatever may come at me, let it come. It don't change my position. It either has to go around me, above me, under me, but it can't go through me because I stand ready. No matter how big it is, Goliath does not cause fear in my life anymore. Some of us had Goliaths. Crack cocaine was a Goliath. Alcohol could have been a Goliath. Anger could have been a Goliath. Telling the truth could have been a Goliath. Well, you misinterpret that as lying. Could have been a Goliath. Fear. There's a lot of people that live in fear. Afraid of tomorrow. Afraid to go to sleep. Afraid of losing things. Afraid of losing people. There are people trapped because of the fear of losing someone. They are trapped in unhappiness because they are afraid of losing. But tonight, the battle that we have won is a battle that overcome all those things in our life. There's a position of faith that we have to take that says only the only thing that could happen to me is good things. Come on. The only thing that could happen to me is things that God have lined up for my life. Let's just think about it for a moment. Let me just pause here for a moment. Let's just think about time. I just think about the days now. The days are fast. Days end fast now. I mean, you up in the morning, before you know it, it's noon, and before you know it, it's the evening, and it's days, time is speeding up. It's speeding up. And you really don't have enough time in a day to get bogged down with things that cause you stress. You can lose a full day stressing over something. You can lose a full day being unhappy about something. You can lose a full day in an argument. Do you know you cannot go back and get that? That's a day that's lost. That's a time that's lost. That is a battle for your time. There is a fight to take out your time, to cause you to be frustrated in your days, to cause you to be unhappy in your days. We have won the battle of peace. Come on, y'all. We have won the battle of happiness. It is time that we use the tools that God has equipped us with. It is time that we walk in the lifestyle that He has equipped us with. One of the things I do, I, I, I drive around and I have students that drive with me, and we go do we do pickups and different things in different areas of the city. And one of the things I do is when I'm driving around and I'll see certain things that, you know, I'm believing God for certain things in my life. And I may pass a certain thing, and I might say, you know, that's exactly the one I want. Oh, I'm going to have one just like that. And one of the things that I've noticed that now they're picking up on it. Now I hear them driving around, Pastor Brad, I'm going to get down right there. I'm going to have me a boat look just like that. I'm going to have me a car look just like that. But it's not about material things. Don't misunderstand me. We're not riding around trying to live on the material, but we are raising our level of believing. See, I have become contagious to them and my level of believing. See, I believe for a $1 million lifestyle. Why should I believe for anything less? What is it going to benefit me to live a $1 lifestyle? What would that benefit? I'm believing for a $1 million lifestyle. Why? Because there are things in the kingdom that I know God want to do in my life. And some of them going to take finances to fund them. There are things that I desire, that you desire to do in your lifetime that is going to take finances to fund them. So why not believe for the finances? See, I have faith for the finances. I believe it's going to happen. So when I see these things, because I live presently on earth, I have not flown away yet. He have not called me up in a whirlwind. I am presently on earth. So there are things on earth that I have privilege to while I'm on earth. Because one day we're all going to go to a king. We're going to live in a kingdom where earth principles won't apply to us. But while we're here on earth and earth principles apply, there are some things on earth I desire to have. Why should the people on TV be the only one have them? Why should I look at someone else's and desire that? No, I call it and claim it and believe it to be a part of my life. Why? Because my king says I can. He said, Matthew 6, 33, he said that. I didn't write that. I didn't write that. He wrote that. He inspired the man to put that in there. So far as I'm concerned, he was talking to me. He put it in there for me to read it. He didn't hide it. He didn't put anyone's name above it or below it. So he put it in there for me to read it. Now, what is my position on what that word says? What is my faith position on that? What is your faith position on what he has said in his word concerning the kingdom? So if I do what he has said, it makes me eligible, qualified to receive what he said I shall receive. So you mean to tell me all I got to do is seek? Oh, I can do that. 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 Pray myself in. Study the word of God. Live by the examples that are in front of me. Obey his word. Tell the devil he's a liar every day. Live victorious every day. Get in this battle and know I've already won. Oh, I can do the kingdom part. I can do that. I can do that. But because I'm doing that, I'm believing for some great things. You know, people, time for suffering is over. Come on. Suffering day, time for suffering is over. Time for lack is over. Time for not having, that is played out. That's like a pair of FUBU jeans. That thing done played out. No more pro wing tennis shoes. Come on. Them things done played out. It is time for us to raise our standards, of life. It is time for us to raise our standards of faith. I am not in no way afraid of believing for something that I can't see. I am believing for things that I cannot see. And I'm going to get things that I can see. It has to come a point in life where you have determined in your heart and in your mind, I cannot settle for less. Why go through life and pass and don't have happiness? Why go through this life and pass and don't have peace? You have to have peace and be satisfied with who you are and how God is using you. I'm satisfied with who I am. Satisfied with that. I'm believing God for more, but I'm satisfied with it. You know, my attitude, it ain't good sometimes, but I'm satisfied with it. You just got to deal with that. You know, I may snap sometimes. I'm satisfied with it. Them your feelings getting hurt. I may not do it exactly like you think I should sometimes. That's you got to try to correct me and assume that I'm listening when I'm really not. It has to come a time that we realize that it was God that made me. It was God that created us. And it was also him that gave his son. It was him that gave his son. But do you know that when he gave his son, he already knew who we were? Do you know when he gave his son, he already knew what he was doing in our life? Do you know when he gave his son, he already knew that some of us hair wouldn't grow long? Some of us would be bald-headed. He knew that already. I'm not being comical. I'm being for real. I'm trying to bring it down to a level simple just to make you understand the simplicity of this thing, but also how powerful it is. It's simple as just accepting who you are and by faith believing that God is going to use your life for his glory. God is going to use your life for his glory. And therefore, the battle that we're called to win, that we're destined to win, the battle that we're called to and destined to win, the battle that we're in, it's a fixed fight. The battle has already been won. The victory is already ours. The victory is already ours. So there's no reason to struggle in that. Tonight I call you to be a witness, to be attractive, an attractive witness. Your witness should draw other people. Something about you should be attractive to draw other people. There are people that are physically attractive, and they get your attention because of the physicalness. But what about the power of being attracted in the spirit? It amazes me sometimes as we go out to some of these different homes that we go in. And you can tell the difference when you walk into certain homes. You can feel and sense the spirit. Time you walk in the door, you can feel the peace in the house. And you'll see a Bible over there. Or you'll see a cross on the wall. Or you'll see a picture on the wall of praying hands. Or you'll see something that represents the kingdom. And you feel a presence and a peace when you walk into that home. And there are some homes that you walk in and you can feel stress. And you can feel unhappiness. And you can see unhappiness. And it has to be at that moment that there's a tug on your heart to say something. To say something. To be a witness to them. To be a witness, to encourage them. Let staff speak first. To be a witness. I'm not telling you go in nobody's house and start preaching. To be a witness. It has to be a time in your life that when you go around people and you don't feel the presence of God, that there's a burning to share him with them? It has to be, this battle is about fighting spiritual warfare. And the victory is the victory when we testify about who he is and what he has done. If you work on a job and there's individuals on your job that don't know you're a Christian, you're not in the fight. So you're not in the fight. You punch at the clock. If you live in a neighborhood and you have neighbors, I'm being serious, y'all. If you have neighbors and your neighbors don't know that that man, that woman, they go to church, they Christians. They love God. If something's wrong, I go over there, they'll pray for me. They've offered to pray for me before. I see them praying all the time. I know them Christians. I don't care what the police over there for, them Christians. I don't know what's going on, but they may be praying for the police. Them Christians over there. People should know these things about you. People should see you passing and say, I know them. Oh, that's sister such, that's brother so-and-so. Because they associate you with the kingdom. And the only way that a person can associate with it is your lifestyle has to be attractive in the kingdom. We have to be attractive. We have to put on. You know, Ephesians talk about the whole armor. But we have to put on something. We have to put on the presence of the Holy Spirit. It's just like putting on makeup. It's just like taking the time to do your hair, them 2 hours you take. That time is delicate time because you want to portray or betray or show a certain image, right? It's the same thing with the Holy Spirit. We take the time to let him fill us with his presence. We take the time to meditate in him. We take the time to be in his presence because we want to show him in our life. We want to show him to be true. We want to show him to be powerful. It was a time in my life. It's funny when I say that, I feel like I'm old. It was a time in my life where I struggled with believing certain things from God. I really struggled with them because what I believed for and the things that I kept seeing happening just didn't line up. So I kind of like felt kind of like I ain't going to keep saying that stuff because seemed like the more I pray and believe for it, boom, something else happened. So it's almost like I ain't going to pray that. It's almost like, you know, you were afraid to pray for certain things. You know, I'm believing God for this, and then wham, a trial, a tribulation come, and it seemed like it's not going to happen. But then one time I was just praying, and I love the Holy Spirit because he just talks to you like a brother. He talks to you like a friend. He talks to you like your best friend. And I remember one time I was praying, and I really was praying hard about something, and a sweet, soft voice from the Holy Spirit said, you have nothing else to live for but today. Today. Nothing else but today. Why doubt? Why fear? You have today. Believe right now. Live for this moment. Believe that all things are possible. You don't have room in your day to doubt. You don't have time in your life to doubt. You only have an opportunity to believe. And I stand here tonight to say, if I spend the rest of my life believing, if I spend the rest of my life not doubting, I will know that I demonstrated faith in him. I will know that I obeyed his word. I will know that I lived a life of peace. And everyone around me felt that peace. Everyone standing. Everyone standing. As we continue in this series that we're in on Wednesdays, called to battle, destined to win. As we continue in them, I encourage you on tonight to really, really open up your hearts and open up your minds to really hear these teachings. But not only to hear them, when you leave this place, pray and talk to God about strengthening and encouraging even you in the midst of the battle. Because we are in a season, as I talked about earlier, it's a different type of revival that is taking place. It's a different type of mode of revival that is taking place. It is a time to be equipped to take your position because we have already won. See, this equipping is not to prepare you to go to fight. See, we already in the fight. We already taking punches. This is to prepare you to take on the winning attitude, to take on a winning position, to say that I am tired of losing. Somebody has to get tired. I am tired of the same old, same old. Someone has to get tired. I am tired of this cycle, this same cycle in my life. It comes a time to get tired of it. Call to battle, destined to win. Destined is a complete word. Destined does not change. His calls in our life is without repentance. He doesn't change his mind about us. He's not going to change what he has called for us to do. And he has called for us to be victorious. He has called for us to be happy, to live in peace, to live in joy. I'm not trying to pump you up. I'm trying to tell you the truth. This is what he has called us to. So it comes a point in life where I have to take a stance and say that I'm tired. Tired of fighting, tired of struggling, tired of the cycle. There's no reason to be in the cycle. He has already given us the victory. He has already given us the battle. I have to take my position in the victory. I have to take my position of faith in this and start living happy. Life is meant for you to live in peace, joy, and happiness in the Holy Ghost. Let me repeat that. Life is meant for us to live in peace, joy, and happiness in the Holy Ghost. That's what it's meant for. That's what it's meant for. Maybe tonight you don't feel like you're there. The altar is open. I ask you to come forward. Maybe tonight you're struggling in that area of your life. The offer is open. I ask you to come forward. Maybe tonight it just doesn't seem like you have peace. The altar is open. I ask you to come forth. Maybe tonight you're struggling because the things and the circumstances in your life, they just don't line up with happiness and peace. Come to the altar tonight. Maybe you're here tonight and you say, Pastor, I really heard those words. And for a long time in my life, I have believed them, but it seemed like I'm stuck in a hard place in my life. It seemed like something is trying to happen, but it just won't break loose. I need a release. Come on. Don't be shy. Don't be ashamed. This is the altar. This is you and God. Be free in your heart. Do you not know that just a simple demonstration of faith, a simple walking out, a simple stepping out on a call, a simple stepping out on a call, is an example to God that you're serious, is an example to God that you're surrendering, is an example to God that you're really pressing in. So press in tonight. The word tonight has come to encourage you. Because, see, the battle is already won. You just got to know where you stand. You just got to know your position. You just have to know your role. You just have to know your call. You have to know your job. You have to understand the task that is before you. And you have to understand how to receive the things that you desire. See, Matthew 6:33, that's a very powerful verse in the Bible. Very, very powerful verse in the Bible. And he put it there for every one of us. So we will know how to accomplish it. How to make it happen. How to allow it to happen. How to receive it when it's happening. Spiritual battle, spiritual warfare is when every one of us that is standing in this place tonight is when we take our place and put a foot down on Satan and say we are determined to live according to the word of God. That's all it is. That's all it is. There's no hocus pocus. It's no magical tricks. It's no demonic stuff. No, and none of that. That stuff don't matter. The Holy Spirit has authority, total authority over every spirit. There's only one spirit in operation in this place, and that's the Holy Spirit. And it has total rule and total authority. So therefore, our fight is not with those things. Our fight is taking our position, understanding this battle, and understanding our role. He has called us to live a certain way. He has called us to live victorious. He has called us to be filled with his presence, his Holy Spirit, to be equipped with it. To be equipped with it, to walk out this battle. Everyone's hand is raised. Everyone's hand is up. The Holy Spirit has filled this place. The Holy Spirit fills us individually. And it's through that Holy Spirit that we have the power to believe in what God is doing in our life. It's through the Holy Spirit that we have the power to live it out. This battle that we have called to, we have been called to a battle that has already been won. So tonight we claim victory. Someone shout victory. Someone shout victory. There is nothing, no weapon, no thing in your life that can prevent you from victory. Yes. He has given you victory. So tonight, release it. Release it. Release it. Whatever is holding you back, release it. Whatever is coming against you, release it. Take it off you. We demand it to come off you in the name of Jesus. Take it off you. By the blood of Jesus, we demand whatever is hindering you to fall off, to come. Chains are broken tonight. We demand a release in the name of Jesus. We call a release. We call a freedom to take place. Release it.
In the name of Jesus. Release it. Release it. In the name of Jesus. Release. In the name of Jesus. Release. Release. In the name of Jesus. Come off. Release. 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 In the name of Jesus. Release. 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 Come on. Release. 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 In the name of Jesus. Release. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Release. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Release. In the name of Jesus. No hindrance. No fear. No shame. Release. Release. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Release. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Release. Release. Release.
Spirit, you are welcome.
In the name of Jesus.
Come flood this place.
Hallelujah. Lord, you cover her. Lord, protect her. Lord, be a shield and a hedge around her. God, go into her home and you take control. Go into every room, every atmosphere. You take control, God. Bring in your authority. Bring in your power. Bring in your anointing. God, bring in your standards. Let there be a release in her life, a release in her home, a release all around her. Release, God. Breakthrough, 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 breakthrough. In the name of Jesus. Release.
Show me.
Right there, right there, right there, right there. Right there, right there. Release. Right there. Boldness, 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 boldness. Boldness, 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 boldness. No fear, no hesitation. Reckless, reckless running forward. Reckless out of control praising. Reckless out of control telling people who he is. Reckless out of control, crazy like. Taking on a mad attitude, going insane, release.
Oh, Jesus, majesty, forever I am changed.
Wash him. Wash him. Wash. Wash.
Holy Hallelujah. Spirit, thank you, Jesus. You are welcome. Holy
yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Spirit, you are welcome.
Like raindrops, like raindrops, like raindrops. God, be like raindrops.
Your glory
be like raindrops, God. Be like raindrops.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Get the Lord some praise. Get the Lord some praise. Get the Lord some praise. There's really no warfare if there's no victory. There's really no battle if there's no fight. The ability to be victorious and to know that you are already ahead of the fight, to know that you have already won the battle, is the ability to look into your future and to see what you want and to see what you desire and call those things that are not as though they be. Can you see it? Can you put a demand? Can you put pressure on the kingdom? Can you put pressure on the kingdom? Can you put a demand on the kingdom? Can you show the kingdom that you are living righteously? And because you're living righteously, you put a demand on the word? Can you, are you brave enough to put pressure on the word? Can you see something and call it into life? No more milk, no more milk. We have to be about meat. There's some powerful individuals in this house. In this house that need to start calling things into existence. They need to, it's people in here that had dreams and that had ideas and that had visions that you have let go dormant. You need to call them back up. You need to raise them dreams back up. You need to raise those ideas back up. You need to raise those visions back up. You need to start talking about it. Angel, remember when we talked about it? And it manifested, did it not? It manifested. We talked about it and it manifested. You need to talk about it. Claim it. Put pressure on it. Visions, dreams, ideas. The kingdom is calling you. The kingdom is calling you. While you are yet young and the light is still in your body, the kingdom is calling you. The kingdom is calling you. Can you witness? Can you testify? Can you just go crazy and insane for what God is doing? Can you go crazy for the Lord? Can you lose your mind for the kingdom? Can you lose your exposure for the kingdom? Your dignity for the kingdom? Man, I tell you, God is awesome. He's awesome, and he's always been doing great, but he's also continually to do great. And in the midst of where we at today, there's a great awakening. Ralph, is a great awakening that's taking place. And it's for us as leaders. In the midst of this great awakening, for us to push the people, push them into excellence, push them into position, push them. Don't even allow them to take anything less. Push them into faith. Push them into taking a stance. See, at the Lighthouse, we're not even going to allow you to slack anymore. We fed up with you. We mad at you. We mad enough to push you into what God is calling you to do. We are upset enough to force you to do what God is calling you to do. We gonna tell you about yourself. Because God has a call in your life. He got a call on you. He got a call on you. Superman. He got a call on you. This time, all the way. This time, all the way. No excuses. This time, all the way. I stand here and I tell you tonight, if you'll trust him, if you'll just open up your heart and walk by faith, sister, not by what it looked like, not by what it seemed like, but you walk by faith, and he will show you a lifestyle that you didn't even think that was possible for you. You have something inside of you that God wants to share. There's a gift that you have. There's a gift, and he wants to use it for the glory of his kingdom. It's not by coincidence that you're in this place for this time. He's going to use you. Have faith. Every situation, you put faith on it and allow God to do the rest. Allow God to do the rest. Can we give God some glory for that?
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's give the Lord some praise for that powerful word. Hallelujah. Y'all ready to take your stance? Y'all got your stick? Devil's running, amen? Amen. Thank you, Pastor Vern, for that powerful word, amen? Hallelujah. God is up to something. God is saying something. When you keep hearing the same thing, God is saying something, amen? Take heed, amen? Amen. We're going to get ready now to receive the Lord's table. Ushers. Amen. As we remember tonight what Jesus Christ did for us, remember that you're not battling to gain victory. You're battling from a place of victory. Amen. He won the victory. So as we take these elements, realize that you're partaking of victory. Amen. Receive the bread now. Y'all ready to drink from the cup of victory? Take a drink. Hallelujah! Glory! Amen. Y'all been blessed tonight? Y'all feel built up? Whew. Y'all should be good to go now. Amen. Amen. We'll be back Friday night. Amen. For a good Friday service. So come on out. And come on out with some powerful testimonies. Amen. Amen. Let's lift our hands up to the Lord. Father, we just thank you tonight for that awesome word. Father, seal it in our hearts. Father, always keep us in that stance of faith, Father God, and to maintain the victory in our lives. Ephesians 3:20. Now, unto him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Amen. Be blessed.